But the choir, your song, and the singing, Miss Sharon, that song is fantastic. If there's ever, now here's how we Baptists are charismatic. We simply do this. Right? That's just how we do it. And it's okay. It's okay to say amen in a song like that. Amen. It's okay to say hallelujah in a song like that. And that song, that choir sang. And by the way, I saw Brother Dan, of course. I stand next to Brother Dan on the praise team here. And of course, you got know how Brother Dan, his voice, his singing ability. And Brother Prater's an old music guy. He sings phenomenal. Yeah, heavy on old. He said, so him on one side, Dan on the other, I sound amazing. Just so you know, I mean, it's amazing. I just went up to professional level right there today, and it's fantastic. Amen. I just love the Lord. He is worthy, and that song we sang, Soon and Very Soon, you guys know I've said that 1,000 times. That song takes me right to the throne of God. It's amazing, and I love singing about my Lord. I cannot wait to see my Lord. I can't wait to see him, and maybe today. And if not, until then, until about lunchtime, we're going to preach, right? So until then, Brother Prater, I'm so glad you're here. You're my friend. I met Brother Prater. We actually met on a phone call, if you remember that. A mutual pastor, Brother John Waterloo. Many of you know Brother Waterloo from years ago. And I called Brother Waterloo one day and said, hey, I'm looking for someone to be a blessing to us and come down and do a marriage conference. He got me connected to Brother Prater. I called him up on a phone call. Said, hey, I want you to come. And we're like, I know. And he was thinking. He's saying, I don't even know who you are. And I said, I don't know who you are either, but I've got some good recommendations. And I couldn't be more happy at the connection that we've been able to make. I feel like we have a pastor brother in the Lord who thinks and feels like we do. I thank the Lord I got more hair than he does. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Better looking. We've had such a joy in becoming their friends. Oh, yeah. I had to wiggle that one in there somewhere. You know I did. We've had such a joy with fellowshipping with Brother and Mrs. Prater and becoming their friends. I'm so glad that he can come and take time away from his church. He pastors the Fellowship Baptist Church in Liberal, Kansas. And by the way, I got to make you've heard this 1,000 times, I know, but there's a Conservative Baptist Church in Liberal, Kansas. Amen. And we're glad for that. And a bunch of liberals up there. We're glad you're here, Brother Prater. Come preach to us, if you will. Welcome to Southwinds.
Thank you. Amen. The moral to that story is some of you have hated John Waterloo ever since. Amen. Now, for my brothers who are like myself, follically challenged, my motto has never changed. They do not put marble tops on cheap furniture. So that's my motto, and I'm sticking with it. Amen. Your preacher's not bald yet, but he's got the power alleys working pretty good there. So, my boys, bless their hearts, they don't have a chance. My son officiates high school basketball, and he was officiating over in Oklahoma Panhandle, school I graduated from, actually. And my brother and I were kind of sitting up in the bleachers high, and Tyler had, he was taking a ball out on the side, and I happened to look down there, and bless his heart. It's starting to work up here, and he just doesn't have a chance. It's a real bummer for him. It's good to have my wife with me. Katie, why don't you stand? It's the best-looking Grammy in all of the world right there. And love her and appreciate her. And I tell you, you got to love a woman who is so incredibly discerning and just always speaks the truth in love. That would be her. The other day, I come out of the bedroom and I said, honey, I think the dryer's shrinking my clothes. And she just smiled and she said, no, honey, it's the fridge doing it. And thank you. That's a blessing. Speaking of truth in love. Well, it's good to be back at Southwinds Baptist Church. Told the folks in Bible study this morning, it's just good to be somewhere warm. I had threatened to tie a snow shovel to the front of my Tahoe and just start driving south until somebody said, what's that? Then I would know I was probably where it was going to be somewhat warm. But it's good to be here. I want to invite you to join me this morning in a chapter of the Bible that has been called Michelangelo's David. It's been called Da Vinci's Mona Lisa. It's been called Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. It's been called Lincoln's Gettysburg Address. We just know it simply as Romans chapter 8. So can we meet there this morning? Paul's writing his letter to the church in Rome there. Let's go to chapter 8. And once you have found your place, I want you to do something for me this morning. Just in your mind, you don't have to write it down necessarily, but in your mind, I want you to pick a date. All right, it can be any date for whatever reason, as long as it's after February the 5th, 1980. That's the only stipulation. Any date, for any reason, just pick a date in your head, maybe a wedding or birth of a child or promotion or Super Bowl or World Series. It doesn't make any difference. Any date after February the 5th, 1980. Got it? How many of you have it? All right, good. If she were here, a woman by the name of Jill Price could tell you, you could just yell out whatever date it was, and if she were here, she could tell you what day of the week that was, whether it was a Monday or a Tuesday or a Wednesday. She could tell you what she did on that day. She could tell you about any major event that took place on that day. She could even tell you what the weather was like on that day. Now, for many of us here today, our problem is remembering. But for Jill Price, her problem is forgetting. She has a very rare condition called hyperthymestic syndrome that has resulted in automatic, autobiographical recall of every day of her life since she was 14 years old. How many of you remember the date that CBS, time out, young people, just chill out a minute, we'll be back. Us old folks are going to go on a journey here, okay? So you young folks, we'll be back, I promise. How many of you remember the date that CBS aired Who Shot JR? How many of you remember what date that was? Jill Price could tell you, like, boom, right now. How many of you remember when they aired the All in the Family baby episode? Jill Price could tell you the day. What about the final episode of MASH? When did it air? Anybody know the last episode? It was February the 28th, 1983. Jill Price could tell you that too. She remembers that it was on a Monday. She remembers that it was raining that day because her windshield wipers stopped working. Now again, to us, that kind of memory seems like a gift. I mean, I'm getting to where I can hide my own Easter eggs now, you know. But having that kind of memory would be a gift, especially if you're trying to remember names or birthdays, or how about this, passwords. Or if you're on Jeopardy, cha-ching, be awesome. But there is a downside. There is a dark side to a memory like that. And in her memoir, The Woman Who Can't Forget, Jill Price writes this. Imagine being able to remember every fight you ever had with a friend. Every time someone let you down. All the stupid mistakes you've ever made. The meanest, most harmful things you've ever said to people. And those they've said to you. Then imagine not being able to push them out of your mind no matter how hard you try. She went on to write, as I grew up and more memories were stored in my brain, More and more of them flashed through my mind in this endless barrage, and I became a prisoner to my memory. Think about that for a minute. A prisoner to my memory. I'm going to venture to guess that I'm speaking to someone here today, maybe a number of folks here today, who can identify with that statement, because you too find yourself living as a prisoner to your memory. A prisoner to your past. And it could be today that some of you have been living there for many, many years. Even though you've confessed your sin, even to this day, you still feel condemned. And you just keep beating yourself up, and you keep sabotaging your own life. You keep believing the self-defeating lies that come from the enemy and become self-fulfilling prophecies. You find it hard this morning to live in the present because you feel trapped by your past. God's got good news for you today. It's found right here in the book of Romans, chapter 8, in the very first verse, where Paul took his quill and he wrote this: "There is therefore now," everybody say now. "There is therefore now," what are those next two words? "No condemnation." There is therefore right now, January the 29th, 2017, no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. I pray that God helps you embrace this truth by faith today. There is no, none, nada, zippo, zilch, not a whiff, not a trace, not a hint of condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. That last phrase, "who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit," is a description of those who are in Christ Jesus. Now that doesn't mean, and I'm not trying to say this morning, that we were never under condemnation. So let's talk about that for a moment, the reality of condemnation in the past. Because the truth is, before we came to know Christ as our Savior, we were most certainly condemned. John teaches us that. John chapter 3 and verse 18, "He that believeth on Him," that would be on Christ, "is not condemned. But he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed on the name of the only begotten Son of God." So during those days, prior to our salvation, prior to our believing in Christ, we were condemned. We were living under the just condemnation of sin. As a matter of fact, when you go home this afternoon, if you choose to do so, read the first chapters of Romans chapter 7, because that's what it's all about. We find there that by virtue of Adam's sin, we were all condemned. We've been told that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God, and that there is none righteous, no, not one. We're told in Romans chapter 6 that the wages of our sin was death, or eternal separation from God. Before we came to Christ, let's just be honest, we were a mess. Didn't matter how much we had it together on the outside, on the inside spiritually, we were a mess. And we had absolutely no hope outside of a relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. But then something happened. For me, it was September 8th, 1976. The day that I heard the gospel. And I was made to realize the mess that I was in. Oh, I knew I was a mess. I grew up in a home. My parents were both alcoholics. I had no rules. I had no time to be at home. I could be where I wanted to with whoever I wanted to. I mean, I was a mess. I look back on our church, and they had to be the most grace-filled bunch of people to welcome a long-haired, loud-mouthed bus kid like me. And I'm glad they loved on me, and I'm glad that they were willing to love me like I was. So I'm telling you, I was a mess. But even a bigger mess was my spiritual life. I didn't know it, but I was on my way to hell. I was condemned by virtue of Adam's sin. I didn't even need Adam. I took care of that myself. I had plenty of sin myself. I didn't need Adam. But I understand now that I was condemned by virtue of Adam's sin. And I started attending Fellowship Baptist Church, and I'm thankful for the day that I grasped the truth in my heart that indeed I was a condemned sinner, desperately in need of a Savior. I believed in my heart and I confessed with my mouth the Lord Jesus, and I called upon the Father to save me. And listen, He did. That Wednesday night at 9 o'clock in my youth pastor's office, Jesus Christ became my Lord and Savior. That day is the day that everything changed for me in terms of my standing before God. That day, September the 8th, 1976, was the day that I stepped into the reality of Romans chapter 8 and verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Listen, that's us. If you're here today and you're saved, we are in Christ. And there is right now, this very moment, absolutely no condemnation. So let's talk about the certainty of no condemnation in the present. Because some of you may be sitting there and here's your thought right now, Pastor Prater, if there's no condemnation, then why do I still feel condemned? In a word, Satan. The Bible calls him the accuser of the brethren. Condemnation is his native tongue. Satan loves to remind us over and over and over again of everything we've done wrong. I told you that I went to a ball game a couple of weeks ago, a little town that I grew up in. My son was officiating basketball there. And I tell you, I don't necessarily like to go back there because I have a lot of skeletons in the closet. And I'll be switched if it wasn't the moment I walked in to pay the gal there. I was face to face with my past. And then the devil started. What are you doing here? Why do you even show up here? People know you here. They've known you your whole life. And the devil loves for us to begin playing over and over again everything we've done wrong. Why does he do that? So that all of our emotional energy is spent on past guilt. But listen, there's no need to feel guilty because of past sins. I can tell you this morning, based upon the authority of the Word of God, that if those sins have been confessed, they have been forgiven, according to 1 John 1:9. But He, God, is faithful. Somebody say amen. God's faithful. And He's just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Listen, we've already been acquitted of those wrongdoings. And we can't be tried twice for the same sin. There's no double jeopardy. And let me tell you this, the force of the no and no condemnation cannot be overstated. It is an absolute negation of our guilt. Once confessed, our sins are forgiven, forgotten forever. They have been nailed to the cross. And I'm telling you today, the hammer of God's grace has no claw. Now listen, if anyone had regrets about their life before Christ, it had to be Paul, the author of the book of Romans. Known as Saul prior to his salvation, Paul was the equivalent to our modern day terrorist. He hated Christians. And he made it his daily goal in life to arrest and imprison, and I'm guessing even in some cases kill as many believers as he possibly could. Only eternity will tell how many families were torn apart because of his invasion into their home and his arrest of mom or his arrest of dad or his arrest of mom and dad simply because of their professed belief in Jesus Christ. But then one day, one glorious day, on a road trip to Damascus, Paul met Jesus. And that day, he stepped into the reality of Romans chapter 8 and verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. That day was a turning point in Paul's life. He eventually became one of the greatest missionaries the world has ever known. God used him to write much of the New Testament. Now, how often do you think Paul wrestled with his past? I'm guessing he probably had his fair share of bouts with the past. But he not only wrestled with his past sin, he wrestled with present sin. Close of chapter 7, he writes about his daily struggle with his old self. He writes about how frustrating it is not to do the things that he knows he should do, but he ends up doing the things that he knows he shouldn't do. And finally, at the end, he just throws up his hands and he said, "Oh, wretched man that I am!" And all of us know about that struggle. We live it every day. It's part of having a sin nature. Paul's daily struggle with sin is why he didn't write in Romans chapter 8 and verse 1, "There is no failure in Christ Jesus." He didn't write in verse 1, "There is no struggle in Christ Jesus," or "There is no wrongdoing in Christ Jesus." Paul didn't say that we would never mess up or that we would never get off track or that we would never speak a hateful word again or act selfishly again or lust again or get angry again. Why didn't Paul say that? Because from his own experience, he knew better. And note this, Paul didn't say there is therefore now no conviction to them which are in Christ Jesus. He said there's no condemnation. And there's a difference between the two. Condemnation is feeling guilty over confessed sin. Conviction is feeling guilty over unconfessed sin. Conviction is healthy. Conviction's good. It's from the Holy Spirit. And it's the way we get right with God and get on with our lives. So you need to tune in to the convicting voice of the Holy Spirit, but you need to learn to tune out the condemning voice of the enemy. What Paul knew was true was what John wrote in 1 John 1:9, and I shared with you a moment ago, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Here's how that works. We sin. The Holy Spirit convicts us. We feel guilty, which, by the way, we should. So much so that we ask God for His forgiveness. We agree with Him about the seriousness of our sin, and we confess it. We beg for His forgiveness, and He grants it. And at that point, our sin is cast into the sea of God's forgetfulness. But here's what the devil wants us to try and do. He wants us to try and go fish it out again. He keeps reminding us of what God has already forgotten. He keeps condemning us for what we've already confessed and what God has already cleansed. And at that point, we must recall Paul's words again: there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. I want to show you a quick video of my son-in-law, Kelby. And believe my motives are pure this morning. I promise they are. Kelby plays professional baseball for the San Francisco Giants. Kelby came to our little community college in Liberal from down in southern Oklahoma, a little town called Elgin around Lawton and Chickasha. He was a last-minute walk-on. He played well enough to get a scholarship and actually became the school's first baseball All-American. He got drafted out of junior college, but he didn't sign. And he went on to play a year, his junior year at Texas Tech, where he was a Rawlings Gold Glove recipient at shortstop. And then he signed with the Giants in 2011. And after a grueling 4.5 years in the minor leagues, he finally made his big league debut in Atlanta on August the 3rd in 2015. His first three professional at-bats, he went 3-for-3 with 3 RBIs. He broke camp with a big league club last year, and then he got hurt. And so he rehabbed and then stayed where he'd play every day down in Sacramento in AAA. And then got called back up in September, and he finished out the year on the 25-man roster. He was in the wild card game against the Mets, and then we played in the series against the Cubs. I just want to show you this little thing that our youth pastor put together for an event that he did where Kelby was speaking, and just a few highlights. And I want to come back and tell you why I showed you that today. Go ahead, Morgan.
Detwiler coming at him again with another fastball.
God's not dead. Are you good? He's surely alive.
He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. He's roaring.
To watch those highlights, you would think that Kelby never struck out, that he never made an error. But to date, he struck out 58 times, and he's made 7 errors. So his career as a professional baseball player has been anything but perfect. But then again, neither has our life. As a Christian, we've struck out a time or 10. We've made an error or 50. But here's what God does. He edits out of the video of our life all of the spiritual errors, all of the strikeouts that we have confessed, and He has forgiven. What you didn't see there was the error he made last year at the beginning of the season against the Dodgers. Nasty rivalry between the Giants and the Dodgers. And his error allowed the Dodgers to score the winning run. Listen, if I'm going to show you the life of my son-in-law, I'm not going to show you that. I'm going to show you the good stuff. And if God were to show a replay video of your life and my life, the sins that we've committed but confessed and He's forgiven, they wouldn't be in there. Matter of fact, he doesn't even remember them. He's removed them as far as the east is from the west. You know the only time that we ever remember those things is when the devil throws them up at us. And I don't know about you, but he's pretty good about that in my life. He loves it when we replay those things over and over again and are overcome with guilt. If you're one this morning that constantly struggles with the past, I want to try and encourage you real quick with three simple statements. Here they are. Number one, your past sins were paid for on the cross. Listen to me this morning. Quit beating yourself up for sins that Jesus has literally, physically, already taken the beating for. Number two, your past does not define you. You are not your past. If you've confessed those sins, you are forgiven because of the blood of Jesus Christ. You are not what you did. You are a new creation in Christ. You are God's masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. You're not what you did. And listen to me this morning. You're not what somebody did to you. You are loved and accepted in the Beloved. Number three, your best days are ahead. The next time you're up and you get to witness the sunrise, just remember that our God is all about new beginnings, new creation. Listen, don't miss out on it by looking in the past. Think about it this way. If you live your life focused on the past, it's like driving to work in the morning and all you do is look in the rearview mirror. It's going to be a wreck. Look ahead and remember this simple statement this morning. I lost my past when I found His presence. Every head bowed and every eye closed. I preach this message at home, and obviously I knew the folks there and knew many of their stories well, didn't know about the guest we had, but I've been here over 35 years and I know their story. And I knew there were some folks that this message would really speak to their heart. I don't know your story this morning, but I'm going to guess that it's not that much different than some of the folks I preach to at home. We all have a past. But again, we lost that past when we found His presence. Here's the question this morning. First of all, have you found His presence? If you've never come to faith in Christ, I'm just going to be straight up honest with you this morning. You're still condemned. This message really doesn't have a lot of application to you this morning, because you're still living under the condemnation of sin. Say, well, preacher, I can live with that. Well, that's really not the issue. The issue this morning is this: can you die with that? It's not whether you can live with it, whether you can die with it. And if we die without Christ, heaven will not be our home. And if you're here this morning and you've never come into the full and free forgiveness of Jesus Christ through salvation, listen, you need to take care of that today. Don't walk out of this building this morning still condemned. Have every evil, wicked, mean, bad, nasty thing you've ever done or said or thought about doing erased, cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Say, well, preacher, I've stepped into that truth. I've been born again. I know that as sure as I'm sitting here. Praise the Lord. But are you living in victory? Or do you find yourself still feeling condemned, still feeling dirty, still feeling guilty? Listen, the devil will do that to you. But I'm telling you, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. If you're still feeling condemned, that's because the devil is beating you up today. Your past does not define you. You're not your past. Your sins have been forgiven. I'd encourage you today, as I turn the invitation over to your pastor, to come. Thank God for saving you. Thank God for washing you clean. If there is unconfessed sin in your life and you're feeling guilty, then do business with God this morning. Take care of it today. Confess your sin. He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. That's in the book. Claim it today. Father, I come before You in the name that is above every name. We sung about that name much this morning. We've tried to make much of the name of Jesus today. And God, I pray for those, anyone here today who may be without Christ and they're still living under the just condemnation of sin. And I pray that today would be their day when they let this pastor know, preacher, I want to be saved today. I want all of my sin forgiven. I want to call upon the name of the Lord. I need to be born again. I know that. And then God, I pray for those here today who've been forgiven. They know that. Yeah, Lord, they're still shackled by the past. God, they've never really been able to gain any firm footing in their walk with You because they keep going back to what they've done or what's been done to them. And God, help them to know today that they're loved. They're loved unconditionally. They're accepted in the Beloved. And God, I pray that You would speak to our hearts today and help us to be men and women who understand what it is to live in grace and the full and free pardon of our sin. In Jesus' name, amen. Preacher.